do we manage clients who experience complex life-threatening alterations in blood pressure, which is certainly something that you will see frequently in your practice? This is Unit 6, and it consists of assessment of clients with critical alterations in blood pressure, nursing management of clients in shock, and nursing management of clients in hypertensive crisis. So it's listed like that on your content outline, but because we'll talk about blood pressures first, I'll just go into the hypertensive crisis, and then we will end by talking about stroke. So depending on how far we get with this lecture, I also will post notes, like if we stop at slide 25, 30, whatever. From that point on, I will post notes, okay? Okay, so just like the cardiac lecture, remember, we began with just a basic review about how the heart functions. So obviously, you all are all familiar with hypertension, but let's look at the definition for hypertension. And remember, it's a persistent elevation of systolic blood pressure greater than or equal to 140, or diastolic blood pressure greater than or equal to 90. However, it is also inclusive of current use of antihypertensive drugs. So if someone comes in, if their blood pressure is 110 over 60, I still classify them as having hypertension based on the fact that they are on antihypertensive drugs, okay? Why is it important for healthcare providers, nurses, to be concerned about blood pressures? Why? Because what does it tell us? It tells us what the heart is doing. Again, if we all go back, what's so important about the heart? The cardiac output. You will see that in every sort of alterations in the cardiovascular system. So what I'm concerned about, it's not just I'm going to poo-poo, oh, it's 210 over 100. I am concerned about how the heart is responding, because how the heart responds tells me about cellular dysfunction, it tells me about tissue perfusion, it tells me about whether or not the cells or the heart itself is going to experience tissue necrosis. So that's why hypertension is important. Okay, so primary hypertension, of course, hypertension is classified as primary and secondary, and for purposes of this lecture, we will only look at primary and secondary and not the substages of each of those. Do you follow me? Because each of them, if you take an in-depth study of hypertension, has their stage one and then their stage two. But we're going, for purposes of this lecture, because we want to look at hypertensive crisis, we'll look at primary and secondary hypertension. So primary hypertension, of course, 90 to 95% of all cases of hypertension are linked to primary hypertension, meaning that we have no idea what the etiology, what the idiopathic cause, what the cause of it is, or the etiology. Sometimes can be referred to as essential hypertension. Now, of course, we speculate about the contributing factors, and what could some of those contributing factors be? Diabetes, obesity, stress. What was that? Smoking. All of those contributing factors certainly can be an etiology of someone's hypertension. So secondary hypertension is elevated BP with a specific cause. 5 to 10% of adult cases are linked to this. And of course, individuals that we know are hypertensive, for example, their renal artery is stenosed, so the impact of that renin release, and as we release the angiotensin 1 that's converted to angiotensin 2, you all remember that, of course, is responsible for increasing, for our blood pressure response. If that renal artery is stenosed, then those individuals are likely to have high blood pressure. So how do we fix that? Then we fix that as we do anything that's stenosed. A doctor will do an angioplasty to open up that renal artery so that we can get perfusion. So all treatment for secondary hypertension, not only do we control the blood pressure, but treatment is also aimed at finding finding out the underlying cause and hopefully fixing that underlying cause. So as nurses, what do we use for our nursing assessment? Of course, with anything, we always going to look at our subjective and our objective data. What is important when we are looking, trying to define or assess someone that has hypertension is, first of all, to ask and inquire about their past medical history. What is their cardiovascular history? Certainly, have they had a CVA in the past? Why would knowing about a CVA in the past be important? Okay, medications, that's good. Because they're at risk for having another, but think about the reason behind the CVA. It's probably linked to their blood pressure, right? So, of course, renal, thyroid disease, certainly any kind of pituitary disorder, and we've already talked about obesity, and certain drugs are responsible for causing hypertension. Family history is also a factor, because if they tell me that my grandfather and my mother, they all have hypertension, then the likelihood, of course, is that they also will have hypertension. Food intake. Any of these symptoms, of course, is what data that we want to collect when we look at our nursing process. Objective data, of course, would be the blood pressure readings, heart sounds, making sure ascertaining whether or not there are any abnormal heart sounds. If I hear S1 and S2, I'm okay. But if I hear S3 and S4, if I'm looking for atrial ventricular dysfunction and hearing those sounds, then it should clue me into how the heart is responding to blood flow that's in the blood vessels. And as a result of that, I should see a change in my blood pressure. Pulses, of course, whether or not someone has edema. And certainly body measurements in terms of their where do we look? When you hear in the public, where do we look when you suspect that someone is probably going to be diabetic and have some sort of cardiovascular issue or some sort of decline in health? Where does the weight collect? In their belly, yes. And of course, mental status changes. Blood pressure has often been referred to as the silent killer. Why is that? Because most often, people do not know that they have high blood pressure until they have manifested the symptom of high blood pressure. They've had a headache for days that's been unrelieved and it causes them to seek medical attention. Or they manifest symptoms such as fatigue, dizziness, palpitation, angina, dyspnea, because they're not getting good cardiac output. They're not getting good perfusion. So certainly when we, again, as we have looked at our cardiovascular system, we've always and often we have to think about the diagnostic studies that we will use that will help us to diagnose hypertension. Certainly we will look at the urinalysis, because remember that hypertension is a responsive sort of syndrome. So whatever is off in the body or whatever is at dis-ease in the body, our body, the blood pressure will respond to be indicative of something that is wrong. Our BUN and our serum creatinine levels, because if our renal functions are off, then certainly one of the etiologies certainly could be our renal artery. So creatinine clearance, am I getting good clearance? Of course, tells me what my cardiac function is doing. And then serum electrolytes, of course, you want to look at the sodium particularly, right? We want to look at the sodium, potassium, mag levels, glucose, serum lipid profiles to tell me what the overall health of an individual is, our uric acid levels through our urine. Certainly we want to look at cardiac function. And then, of course, we cannot diagnose someone with hypertension with certainly knowing what their ambulatory blood pressure monitoring is. And of course, that is when the person comes into the doctor's office and they have, one of the primary assessments that they do in doctor's office is always to take a blood pressure. Even if you come in with strep throat, right? They want to know what your blood pressure reading is. And certainly if you do get an abnormal high first-time blood pressure reading, then the doctor's office will probably have you sit for a while and they will take it again. If it's unusually high at that moment, then they should get you, because remember, according to American Heart, you need three successions of high blood pressure in order to be classified as hypertensive. So, of course, we are all familiar with how to take blood pressures. For an individual who has consistently come into the doctor's office with those three, I start them on my antihypertension, and of course I want them to either at home at the drugstore or come back into the office certainly to get blood pressure readings. So let us move into a hypertensive crisis. Yes, ma'am.
Are the three on different hospital visits, or can it
be? No, the same visit.
The same visit?
Yes. Yes, the same visit. Yes. And I will tell you, we all know, certainly if you get a elevated blood pressure reading the first time around, most doctors will probably not discharge you from their ambulatory site. I'm not talking about the ER, okay? But most doctors from an outpatient facility will probably not discharge an individual who has a blood pressure, let's say, of 170 over 90, right? Without starting them on some sort of therapy for that blood pressure. However, where we've fallen down at, which is what we see, is that people don't often do the follow-up from a blood pressure. So then they end up back, then they end up in the emergency room because either the 5 of lisinopril that was prescribed for them did not do what we needed it to do to control their blood pressure. So hypertensive crises are of two types. Hypertensive emergencies, which I'm sure you have seen, and those of you who are doing your ER rotations, and hypertensive urgencies. If you're doing your ICU tele rotation or your ED rotation, then I'm sure you have had the pleasure of patients that have had these classifications. A hypertensive emergency occurs over hours to days, and that is consistently a blood pressure that is greater than 220 over 140. We typically see these individuals in hypertensive emergency who unfortunately have already been diagnosed with hypertension, but have either decided not to take the blood pressure medicine because it makes them feel sick, or for some reason they're non-compliant. So they're either not taking their medicines, or they have decided, or lack of access to getting their high blood pressure medicine, or lack of finances to getting their high blood pressure medicine, which we have seen. I'm sure that you all have had that experience with an individual who unfortunately was supposed to be on antihypertensive, but the insurance company does not pay for that type, or they cannot get to the pharmacy to pick up the med, or they don't have the money for it. Of course, remember that the complications of hypertension, because it impacts my cardiac output, and I will always go back to this, because it impacts cardiac output, what will I expect to see manifested eventually? Because the body cannot last that long at that level. So if my cardiac output is impaired, what else is going to be impaired?
Kidney.
Everything, right? Because ultimately it's cellular dysfunction. Cellular dysfunction leads to tissue dysfunction. Tissue dysfunction means that the tissues will die, so my organs will die. So hypertensive urgency is a blood pressure that's greater than 180 over 110. And with a hypertensive urgency, which means that someone has consistently had this elevated blood pressure, they land into the ER, and we probably can give them either an injection or a PO medicine, watch them for a little bit, and guess what? Their blood pressure comes down. Okay? I thought this someone had a question. So, it says here the rate of rise is more important than the absolute value, because what as nurses do we particularly want to pay attention to when we look at numbers in hospital, when we look at heart rates, when we look at blood pressures? What's more important than the absolute value?
Change in the fever.
What do you mean? Oh, what was that, Diane?
How quick it changed. You took a blood pressure at 8 o'clock in the morning and then you took it at 11, and it's, you know, twice as much. That's a problem right there.
Yes, and then what happens after that? Does it stay there or come down? Like, am I concerned because the patient has been, let's say, 130 over 70 for a while, and then all of a sudden I get this 180 over 100, and then my next blood pressure, and should I be concerned about that or not?
Yes,
well, why?
Because your heart's working harder, and you're going to have complications.
Right, and I'm more concerned with the trend at that moment, right? Because if it drops back to 130 over 70, then that tells me what about the 180 reading?
Might have just been a
fluke. Right, exactly. Okay, so clinical manifestations of individuals who are in hypertensive crisis, meaning that they have had this sustained blood pressure. I don't get this one reading, 220 over 100, and then we don't see that reading again. But they have a sustained reading that's elevated. So those are the individuals you will see who, one of the students had a patient who was sitting home and he had a headache for a couple of days. He had not taken his blood pressure medicine. However, when he presented to the facility, he had already had a stroke because he had gone days without taking his blood pressure medicine and he had a headache for a couple of days. So after that, of course, then we get even further decomposition of our systemic vascular system. So people that are in hypertensive crisis, what do I expect to see manifested clinically? Certainly headache, nausea, vomiting, seizures, confusion. They end up in comas. Renal insufficiency, because again, if my cardiac function is impaired, then all other organs will be impaired. And the kidneys are almost the first to go. Why? Well, lack of blood flow, true, but think about how the body works. Ready? It's going to shunt everything to my core, right? So it's going to make sure that my lungs are taken care of, that my heart is taken care of, and my brain is taken care of. So the kidneys are not a part. The kidneys will work to preserve itself, will unpreserve itself so that the primary organs can save themselves. So of course with hypertensive crisis, again, we will get cardiac decomposition. So you will often see patients who have these high blood pressures. If the heart is working harder and there is plaque or buildup sitting in the heart, then certainly, or lack of perfusion to the coronary arteries, sometimes these individuals may manifest having a heart attack or heart failure, pulmonary edema, or certainly if they already have an impaired aorta. And then if they have an impaired aorta and my heart is working harder, think about it as a thrashing of force up against blood vessels. Because then if an aortic dissection means that my aorta is non-compliant or is losing its compliant or is shearing layers, then certainly if my blood vessels are working harder, then the possibility that that aortic will rupt is increased at this point. Okay, so when we think about hypertensive crisis, we have to look at, so then what is my role? What do I do? How do I manage a person that's in hypertensive crisis? And remember, we're talking about not only hypertensive emergencies, but hypertensive urgencies as well. So certainly, IV drug therapy is certainly one of the primary medical treatments when a patient comes in, because I want to get the blood pressure down, but not too fast, right? Because what will happen if I get it down too fast? It'll go too low. So if I get it down too fast, let's think that if my brain is used to getting nutrients based on a certain level, and I automatically take that away at a rapid rate, what's going to happen to my brain? What was that?
Lack of blood supply.
Lack of blood supply. Immediately. So lack of blood supply certainly could mean that certainly you're going to get altered mental status. But at that point, then I will lose, at that point, then the person's mental status will change. And actually bringing it down too fast, meaning that I'm decreasing perfusion fast enough, then my brain will die, right? Because think again, if you always go back to what happens to cardiac output. So if I rapidly take down a blood pressure, and the brain is not getting adequate perfusion, then what happens to my brain?
It dies.
Atrophy, or it dies. Because think, if you go back to what is the complication of the heart not adequately perfusing?
Tissue necrosis,
because this is going to help you with stroke. It's tissue necrosis, because that's all stroke is. It's tissue necrosis or cellular dysfunction. Okay, so that's what happens when we bring it down too fast. Of course, we want to monitor the cardiac and renal function, because certainly patients who, if you think about what the heart or what the body tries to preserve, and if my kidney functions are not adequate, but I have managed to save my vascular, if I manage to save my cardiac function and my brain and my lungs, then I have to think about what can I do to help them repair the kidneys. Sometimes we can't, so then what's the other alternative? Dialysis, and certainly neurological checks, okay? And then we have to determine what is the underlying cause, because if we treat the cause, then we will ultimately treat the blood pressure. And of course, education to avoid future crisis. When we talk about education, we have to not only remember your subjective data, we have to think about what medications the individuals are on, right? So if we think about what medications they're on, are they on antihypertensive meds? But not only those, but we have to think about medications that can potentially lead someone into a crisis. Can you think of any medications you've been exposed to, if a patient doesn't take that correctly, that may lead them into some sort of hypertensive crisis? Diuretics. Mm-hmm. Why?
Because they cause heart failure. Is that what you're about?
Think about a medication. Yes, ma'am.
Cortisol?
Cortisols. You mean steroids, right? Mm-hmm. That too. And what else?
Would you wonder if they stop any certain medication abruptly?
Yes. Why would that be important?
Because it could cause.
And what medications particularly? Oh, that's a good, because what response do we get? Because we could put them into adrenal crisis, right? Good. Very good. And also, if you all remember learning about MAO inhibitors, remember those, right? Remember what was specific about those drugs? What could we not take them with? Certain what? Certain foods, exactly. What foods could we not take those with? Exactly, because if we do, what happens? I'm hearing. More, because thiamine builds up in the system. Yes, so then with those patients, we do see them present in hypertensive crisis. Might want to know that, just saying. You might see that in your practice, you know? Just saying. Okay, so, of course, so we've dealt with hypertensive crisis, which means an elevation in blood pressure. When patients are in crisis or in urgency, their blood pressures are elevated. However, when blood pressures are low, a patient is in shock. And shock is a clinical syndrome. A clinical syndrome, shock is always characterized by decreased tissue perfusion. That is what I must be concerned about when someone is in shock. Decreased tissue perfusion. Obviously, if my organs are not getting the nutrients in the blood, in the oxygen that they need, then it's going to lead to the complication of the tissue dying. Or not only that, but impaired cellular metabolism, because then the cells will convert from aerobic to anaerobic metabolism because of the lack of oxygen in order to reserve itself. So obviously with shock, we see an imbalance in supply demand for oxygen and in nutrients. Shocks can be classified in three ways. Hypovolemic shock, which I'm sure that you all have had exposure to. Low volume normally caused by, you see these with surgery patients who are bleeding out, or trauma that we don't see that injured the internal organs, and of course the person is bleeding. Or cardiogenic shock, which you certainly, cardio meaning that my cardiac muscle has been impaired. So you typically will see these with people who have had MIs. And distributive shocks, of course, meaning a widespread vasodilations. Those are of three types: anaphylactic shock, septic shock, which you all have seen from infection, and neurogenic shock when you get a spinal cord injury. So let's talk about hypovolemic shock, which is a low blood flow. Of course, it is loss of intravascular fluid. You see this when patients are hemorrhaging. You also see it, which we don't think about, when patients have been severely ill through, patients are dehydrated. And that's why we are often concerned about the little elderly person who comes into the hospital, failure to thrive. You may wonder, well, why do we admit someone who's failure to thrive? Because the potential is they could end up in shock. Or people who've been home for weeks with days with GI bugs, you know, that they are vomiting and have diarrhea, especially if they're of elderly. And of course, fistula drainages from our dialysis patients, diabetes insipidus, because they're voiding a lot, so we can't keep up with the systemic fluid intake. Hyperglycemic individuals and patients who are certainly diuresing. Relative hypovolemia results when fluid volumes move out of the vascular space into extravascular space. And you will often see this with patients who are third spacing. You see this in the critical care area where the patients are edematous all over or have anasarca, where they have generalized edema. I'm sure if those of you who have done your critical care, I'm sure in the critical care rotation you have already seen someone in septic shock, probably, or cardiogenic shock, because it's more popular than we would care to know. So pathophysiology of hypovolemic shock here. You, of course, if it's hypovolemic and my blood volume is low, then certainly I have decreased circulating volume. And then of course, if my circulating volume is low, think about, remember, as I get venous return back to the heart muscle or the cardiac system, remember that's going to be low. So if that's low, then my preload is going to be low, right? Right? Remember what preload is? Someone, remember what preload is? What is preload?
The amount of blood that's going to be pushed through the heart.
What is it? Yes, it's that amount that's left over. Remember, they're sitting at the bottom of the balloon, remember? So of course we need a certain amount to help our ventricles have great compliance. So if I'm getting decreased venous return, then remember what the stroke volume is, the amount of blood per stroke, so to speak. I have to have a certain amount. If I don't, remember, not only do I see a decrease in my systemic circulation, but but my coronary circulation as well, because then my cardiac muscle is not being perfused properly, right? Okay, so decrease again cardiac output, and which will lead to decreased cellular oxygen supply, which leads to decreased tissue perfusion and impaired cellular metabolism. And then what do we expect to see clinically for someone who is hypovolemic? Why are they, I heard it, they're trying to compensate. The body is trying to compensate. So obviously, initially we will see patients have this hyper mood state, tachypnea, because they're trying to get more oxygen to their blood. So how does the heart respond? By increasing in cardiac output, by increasing its heart rate. So then, of course, because I get decreased venous return, I'm going to get decrease in stroke volume. And then certainly, we certainly will try to certainly hypovolemic shock will certainly require fluid resuscitation, right? How else would we treat? If it's low volume, what do I have to get to replace the volume? Fluids. Primarily fluids. So then you have to think about this balance that has to take place in the body, because if I give them too much fluids, then they may get fluid overload, right? So then certainly this is where your central venous pressure and your pulmonary wedge pressures, this is where they come into play. If I'm looking at those hemodynamic monitoring devices, then it will help me to try to balance between fluid intake and what I am getting out. And then obviously if shock impairs my kidneys, how am I going to get the fluid out? If I have impaired renal function, dialysis or what else? Diuretics, what else? If you say diuretics, medications, right? There are medications that help us to improve our renal function. Like dopamine, those of you who have had your critical care rotation, you may have seen someone on a dopamine drip. So a dopamine drip at a low dose certainly improves our renal function. So then what is one of the assessments I'm going to look at? A patient's on dopamine and I'm giving them fluid and BUN, creatinine, but what else? Before I even draw blood from them. Output. I'm going to look at the output, urine output, hourly urine output. So certainly, yes, ma'am.
Is Ebola, is that hypovolemic shock or septic shock?
Ebola? I would classify that probably as a, well, it depends. I mean, I bet you Ebola, I would classify that as septic shock because it involves an infection. Right? But their clinical manifest, remember, they have diarrhea, those patients. So
they third space and bleed out, right? So wouldn't it be hypovolemic?
That's a good question. Wow. Yes, ma'am. Why? Yes. Yes. So certainly, of course, because we're trying to, and we'll talk about that, trying to increase, we have to increase, Laura, say your question loud. Why would we?
Would you give vasopressors to increase their blood pressure and increase cardiac output?
Always go back to. So cardiogenic shock, of course, always involve the cardiac muscle. It means that my cardiac muscle, for whatever etiology, is experiencing systolic or diastolic dysfunction. Again, I have a compromise in cardiac output. Precipitating causes, primarily you'll see this with patients who have had MIs or certainly cardiomyopathy, certainly when they lose compliance of the left ventricle, blunt cardiac injury to the cardiac muscle, pulmonary hypertension, meaning they have high pressures in their pulmonary artery, cardiac tamponade, again, what is cardiac tamponade? Yes, thank you, Ramon.
Is there fluid surrounds the heart and smushes it?
Yes.
So that it can't...
I like that explanation. So that it can't do what?
So that it can't contract, or I mean, can't...
Yes.
Too much pressure so there's not enough cardiac output.
Too much pressure so there's not enough cardiac output, okay? And of course, it smushes the heart. I like that definition. So when we look at certainly the pathophysiology of cardiogenic shock, whenever you look at any kind of shock, and if I'm thinking about shock, certainly is a decrease in tissue perfusion, which means that I will also get a dysfunction in cellular metabolism. What these patients most often manifest, if we do not do any of those corrective measures, then they will get systemic inflammatory response syndrome, because the body is certainly trying to compensate by working, and then eventually these patients die because they have multiple organ dysfunction syndrome, which means the cardiovascular system, the lungs, certainly the GI system, every system of the body is impacted. And unfortunately, when we get to that stage, the non-compensatory stage of shock, then that is typically the point of no return for the patient. Okay, so cardiogenic shock. Certainly, any sort of shock, you will see tachycardia, because the heart is trying to work fast to get oxygen and nutrients to the tissues. Hypotension, because we can't keep up with it. And certainly you will get increased myocardial oxygen consumption. And certainly if we do our mapping for our pulse pressures, we will get a neural pulse pressure, because atrium and ventricles can't keep up with one another, okay? Anaphylactic shock. Certainly those, when someone says they have a peanut allergy, we should all be concerned, because most of the time people who have peanut allergies certainly manifest it, they should have an EpiPen, and it typically manifests itself in an anaphylactic shock. You will see, unfortunately, most anaphylactic shocks, we don't catch them in time, right? I mean, think about it. You're out at the restaurant. You don't have the EpiPen, you're allergic to seafood, shellfish, you're allergic to the peanuts, and unfortunately by the time EMS gets to the site, we've already reached the point of no return, because the airway is closed up, the body has clamped down. However, the issue with anaphylactic shock is you get this vasodilation, because you get increased capillary permeability, right? So then the fluids leave the intracellular and go to the extracellular area. So then these patients develop edema, where primarily the anaphylactic shock, their airway closes. Edema right here. So unfortunately, when patients present, and most often may not even present, but in the hospital setting, we will see this when patients get what sort of medium that we did not know they were allergic to. Dye, x-ray dye. They have a CAT scan and they get injected, and all of a sudden, They say they can't breathe or something. I mean, it happens within minutes. So that's when we see that in the hospital setting. But typically, outside of the hospital facility, if those individuals don't have EpiPen, then more than likely, they don't make it. Because by the time treatment gets to them, it's already too late. So how do they typically present? Certainly, confusion for lack of, dizziness for lack of. And of course, if you've ever been in a CAT scan and someone has gotten IV dye, immediately they feel like, I don't know if they won't say doom, but it's like something, they know something is wrong. And they know something is wrong. Something is wrong. Certainly chest pain. And then some patients, I don't know why, if you've ever been, who's had a CAT scan before? Have you felt that when you feel that go through you and you can feel it in your renal area? You feel that flush in your renal area? Doesn't feel too good. So certainly they will exhibit swelling of the lips and the tongue, and certainly they get the angioedema, wheezing, and stridor. These patients, you see, they get flushed to the skin, pruritus, the itch of certainly. Unfortunately, if the pruritus was a was an initial response, then maybe we could catch it now. Anaphylactic shock can not only be immediate. Remember, if you remember, it's that response to the IgE, that hypersensitivity response. It can not only be immediate, but remember, 12 hours later, you can see patients manifest. Someone who has taken a lisinopril, and you do see that. Someone who has taken a lisinopril, and then they swallow it, it absorbs into their system systemically, and then they end up having a late response of a hypersensitivity reaction, certainly respiratory distress, circulatory failure. And then, of course, probably the most common to all of us, one of the types of distributive shock, of course, is septic shock. And we do see this when, unfortunately, someone has developed an infection. And that is why we should get concerned when the 75-year-old or elderly patient develops a urinary tract infection, because a lot of them develop urosepsis in the hospital, you know, or their home. Yes, ma'am.
I had a patient that had urosepsis in the ED, came from Chesapeakewood, and when he came in during the middle of the night, and the nurse pulled back the sheets to look at his catheter that he got placed in a week before in the emergency department. There was crust all over the urethra.
Oh.
It looked like the tubing had pulled, or his urethra opened and stretched it out. There was fecal matter all in his pubic hair.
Oh.
And it was a very big deal. He had a temperature of 102 degrees. His blood pressure was very low, and it was just a very big issue. And it was only a weak matter that he had left the emergency department with a new catheter, and a week of not being taken care of. And he was a total care patient, to speak with.
That's why he had the indwelling?
Mm-hmm. No, it wasn't indwelling. It was a regular catheter.
Oh, okay, that's what I mean. Indwelling. Why did he have a Foley catheter, though?
He was neurologically...
Neurogenic bladder. So, you see why, remember now, the CDC is so particular about catheter placements in hospitals because of causing urinary tract infections and leading to urosepsis, septic, and then death. That's sad.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
The supervisors were called throughout the night, and they wouldn't respond, and it was very upsetting. And then the doctor wanted to discharge him at 8 o'clock in the morning, even though his blood pressure was still very low, and it dropped to about 70 over 40, and that's when he's like, oh, I can't release him.
No.
He was going to discharge him early that morning. Mm. His WBCs were high.
220 something, probably.
It was 15.
Yeah. Mm. So, of course, you see this, certainly an infection starts, it could start mildly and then progress, and unfortunately by the time it has progressed with not treatment, the person could end up with sepsis and then end up in septic shock. And unlike the other shocks, septic shock or someone who's in sepsis, remember most shocks, the skin is cool and clammy. Does that make sense? Right? Cool and clammy. However, if a person is in septic shock, typically they have warm skin initially because of the infectious process that is going on. So typically you will see them initially. Yes, ma'am. Most shocks. That is one of the certain clinical classifications. Because why? Right, I'm getting decreased cardiac output, right? So the blood flow is coming this way. So certainly they're clamped down. You almost will always get cool and clammy with anyone who's in shock. And of course, they're hypotensive. right? So I'm not getting good, adequate perfusion or cardiac output. However, patients who are in septic shock initially, their skin temperatures are warm and flush. Because I'm not only, yes, ma'am.
I was just gonna give an example of that. We had a patient in the ER, and we were thinking that she was septic, and we took her temperature orally, and it was 97.9, and we were like, this just doesn't add up. We were changing her, and we felt her skin, and she was like, she is so warm. So we took her rectal temp, and it was 104.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
Elderly?
Yeah.
Yeah. Elderly. So certainly, again, with all classifications of shock, the complication is that that the patient will eventually end up with organ dysfunction. So septic shock, of course, the presence of sepsis with hypotension, and of course, despite fluid resuscitation. Remember, patients who are in shock require a lot of fluid volume. And always, classification of shock is inadequate tissue perfusion. So if my tissues are not getting adequate oxygen, then I'm going to be hypoxic, right? Because hypoxia is low oxygen concentration. So this will help you to identify patients who are in shock. So of course, again, this is just a grid mark of the pathophysiology of septic shock. We of course get that invading microorganism. It's always going to start with that. And then of course you get your release of those pro-inflammatory cytokines. And remember that in that IgE hypersensitivity response, you certainly get this inflammatory response where, remember, the cytokines communicate to the other cells how to respond during any sort of endothelial damage, okay? And then, of course, my central nervous system. Remember, we get vasoconstriction initially because why? What's the body trying to do? The body is trying to compensate. However, the body cannot keep up with the demand for compensation, so then the body fails. And I get decreased cellular oxygen supply, which of course leads to decreased tissue perfusion, which leads to impaired cellular metabolism. And then with septic shock, what do I typically see? These are sometimes patients who are in cellular septic shock, distributor shock, because you get this widespread vasodilation, you will get increased coagulation and inflammation. So sometimes, unfortunately, when we have patients, so what lab markers would I probably want to look at for this patient? If there's an issue with coagulopathy, what lab markers am I going to look at? Yes, I'm going to look at my coag studies, right? Because certainly, unfortunately, what can happen is you get these obstructive, because the blood is not thinning as it should, so I get this clumping mechanism in my organs. And if that happens, what can happen to these patients?
Stroke.
They can stroke out. And that's how then we call that obstructive shock, so to speak, but they can certainly stroke out. And of course, the body goes into, again, this compensatory mechanism with this hyperdynamic state where the body is really trying to compensate by increasing cardiac output and decreasing systemic vascular resistance. And of course, our major effects of septic shock, we talked about this vasodilation where certainly if the vessels are dilating, what does that mean for my blood pressure? If my blood pressure is so then, that's the correlating factor, hypotension. Of course, and maldistribution of blood flow, certainly what organ have we talked about that gets impaired initially or first? The kidneys, right. And so, of course, myocardial depression, because again, I have decreased venous return back to the heart. If I have decreased venous return back to the heart, then I have decreased preload. If I have decreased preload, then my stroke volume is decreased, and then I'm not getting good cardiac output. Okay, we often, again, most all shocks manifest themselves in similar manners. Of course, I'm going to see an increased rate in my respirations because my body is going to try to infuse with more oxygen to attach to my hemoglobin so that I can provide adequate perfusion to my organs, of course. And then you certainly get this temperature dysregulation, of course, with septic shock, because what is the body also doing? Trying to fight what? Trying to fight the infection. And of course, because all of my blood flow has been concentrated to my core, a decreased urine output, a certainly altered neurological status because decreased perfusion to my brain, and certainly GI dysfunction because my GI tract will not be getting perfusion as it should to work. It's not going to be getting oxygen to work. So with these individuals and patients who are in shock, you sometimes will see bowel infarctions or bowel obstructions because motility of the GI tract certainly has been decreased by virtue of this multi or multiple organ dysfunction. And certainly respiratory failure is common. Does that make sense? Because I'm not getting any oxygen. And then certainly, we talked about hemodynamics, certainly now neurogenic shock. It's also a distributive shock because you get this widespread vasodilation that occurs. Now, you will see this when patients come in from a car accident, spinal cord injury, or a patient that's had blunt trauma to them, and patients can be sitting, or a patient who has fallen from a tree, but they think, oh, it's nothing initially, because patients can actually be home for a while before, and then what happens is they lose sensation in their lower extremities, or their bowel habits change. That's why we ask patients all when they come into the hospital, when patients have back problems, have you noticed during the triage process, one of the questions that the doctors ask, have you had any dysfunction with your bowel or your bladder? So that the doctor can ascertain whether or not the spinal cord has been compromised. So with these patients, of course, they'll be able to talk to you, but they will have decreased sensation, decreased vascular return, numbness, tingling, some of those neuropathic problems that you will often see manifested with patients who have neurovascular dysfunction, or even patients who same similar symptoms as patients who are diabetic patients. You know how they have that neuropathy? So these patients will come in, they know they're not diabetics, but they know something is wrong. I can't feel my toes. It's numb down the bottom. Something is wrong with me. And then because the body, is trying to, again, repair itself, the body is trying to repair itself by bringing perfusion there, then what do I expect to see? Say that again. Right, because what is my body trying to do? My body is trying to compensate. That's the answer. The body is trying to compensate, okay? So, of course, you can also, one of the common complication after surgery, after a patient has had what type of surgery that may lead to a neurogenic shock? Oh, an epidural. yes, any kind of epidural or patients who have just delivered, mothers who have just delivered who have had a spinal, can end up in neurogenic shock because of, by virtue of where the needle has ended up, unfortunately. That's a complication, that patients have neurogenic shock and you get this vasodilation response, this disruption in the sympathetic nervous system, and of course you lose your sympathetic tone, because really when you go to assess them and say push down and they've lost their motor tone, you know something is wrong, right? Especially when you have assessed them prior and they were able to do that. That should be a key that something is wrong with my patient if I'm not able. And again, you see the same clinical manifestation. Decreased blood pressure, you certainly see decreased cardiac, because I have decreased cardiac output, I have decreased venous return back to the heart, so it certainly is going to impact my stroke volume, which will impact my cardiac output, of course. And if my cardiac output is impacted, then I'm not getting good cellular. Yes, ma'am. Say that again. Yes, so what happens? Think about this. That's good. That's a good question. It goes down. But think about this. If my atrium and my ventricle cannot keep up with each other and I'm not getting good cardiac output, what happens to my blood pressure? Yeah, so the heart's working. The heart is trying to work. Do you see tachycardia with a low blood pressure? Right? So the heart, so the system is trying to work. It cannot keep up with this demand. Because if the ventricles, and if your atrium and your ventricles are contracting at a fast rate, am I getting good cardiac output? I'm not, right? I can't, because it's too fast. Right? If it's too fast, if just think about, again, think about the balloon again. Okay, if the balloon is filled with water and I have to, if I'm clapping down fast, right, to get balloon out of the water, think about if I did one big clap, I'm going to get a lot of water out of that balloon, right? But if I'm getting these fast little claps, I'm getting little spurts of water out of the balloon. Tiny, tiny, right? So if the heart is working really fast and it cannot keep up with that normal rhythm of the atrium filling, contracting, ventricles filling, contracting, if it's not able to keep up with that normal rhythm, am I going to get, think about your preload. So how much blood is going to be left in my ventricles? Am I going to eject it all out? Because I can't. Right? Because the system is happening too fast. The system is running too fast. So if the system is running so fast, fast heart rate, then, and I don't get the stroke volume that I need because I don't get all of the blood out, then do I have the blood exerting on the vessel walls that I normally would? I don't. So then how will that show up in the blood pressure? What would that number look like? It would be a low blood pressure.
So initially in shock, you would have tachycardia.
Right.
Later,
why is, no, you have tachycardia, but you're going to have a low blood pressure. But why do you have a low blood pressure?
Because
the your heart.
They're not exerting. They're not pushing out of the blood.
Right. Yeah, your heart rate initially, your heart rate is initially fast. See, is how does it say low? When you get a low blood P, why would you get a low blood pressure? Because initially your heart is working fast to compensate for what is systemically going on.
But that
That's with neurogenic shock. I'm sorry, with neurogenic shock.
you have an increased blood pressure?
Now listen. So with distributive shock, because it's vasodilation, which you get wide, remember, vasodilations open up, you will initially, you will, with neurogenic shock, we call this a hemodynamic phenomenon because it works opposite of what I'm accustomed to, okay? So initially, with neurogenic shock, because you are, let's see, how can I explain it? So with you only see this with neurogenic shock, okay? Only when the spinal cord is involved. Only with neurogenic. Typically with shock, initially what you're, the classic sign, initially you're going to see a high blood pressure, I mean a high heart rate, which makes sense, right? Because the body is trying to compensate. The body is trying to compensate because of low volume, or because the heart has been impaired, right? Because the heart has been impaired. Now, after you see here, what are you looking at here? Decreased heart rate will come as a result of having decreased cardiac output. Because think about it. If I'm tachycardic, if the heart is working fast and I got low blood pressure, low blood pressure is going to mean that the blood coming back to the heart is going to be low, and eventually what has to happen? And what's, how's that going to manifest itself in my heart rate? It's going to start beating slower. Yes. Well, it's going to try to fill more, but it can't. But actually, the heart simply has gotten tired, so to speak. Okay, because initially the heart is trying to compensate and keep up with the extra. Remember, stroke is this. Stroke is the inability of the body to keep up with supply and demand. That's what stroke is. Decreased tissue perfusion, right? So initially, with everything, remember how the body is a compensatory mechanism, right? You have a fever. How does your body respond? Your body uses all those inflammatory processes to try to correct itself. So initially, the body tries to correct itself by pumping faster. Remember, the person who is running should have a fast heart rate. Why? To keep up with oxygen supply versus oxygen demand, right? So that's the same way with the person in shock. The heart is going to increase because it has to keep up with oxygen supply and oxygen demand. However, because the heart can't do it, and I get decreased cardiac output, think about the system going around. If cardiac output is decreasing and my stroke volume is decreasing, venous return is decreasing, then how is that eventually going to manifest itself in the form of a blood pressure? Low, decreased blood pressure, right? So now I have a low blood pressure, right? What's going to happen to my heart rate eventually? It's going to decrease, right? Because think, low blood pressure, what's the vascular doing? Right, it's dilating, right? The vascular is dilating, so it's wider, right? It's wider. So then if I now have, because I could not keep up with the cycle, then the heart is eventually going to slow down. So then my heart rate is going to go down because the heart is slowing down. I don't think so. I have to think about that.
Do you want to take a break?
Sure. But what is important to know about shock is what?
Everything's going down.
No. What is shock? There you go. That's the important thing to know about shock. Yes. Okay. Yes. 10-minute break. Melissa had a wonderful question about neurogenic shock, and I was telling her how which good phraseology is to think about it as if it's neurogenic shock, obviously your neuro system is involved, right? So just like if cardiogenic shock is an impairment of the cardiac muscle and sepsis is, let's say, an impairment of your body's ability to respond to an infection or that inflammatory response, right? And again, if anaphylactic shock is an impairment in that hypersensitivity or immune response, the neurogenic shock is an impairment in your neuro system. And remember that the neuro system is composed of sympathetic and parasympathetic, meaning sympathetic speeds up and parasympathetic slows down. So there is a disconnect between those two systems, and that's why you get that hemodynamic phenomenon where you should see a typical, if the heart rate is fast, the blood pressure is low. But with neurogenic shock, because the neuro system is involved and a part of the vagus nerve is innervated through the cardiac muscle, so when you want the neural system, the sympathetic nervous system, to get involved and speed up the heart rate, which is what it's supposed to do, right? And then what does the parasympathetic do to the heart rate? It slows it down. So unfortunately, in that disconnect system with the spinal cord injury, you get an unopposed parasympathetic response. So then you always get a bradycardic syndrome, okay? And then, so hopefully that'll help a little bit for as much as is good for us to know, okay? And then on page 690 of your textbook, if you look, it has that nice little, it talks about the chemoreceptors, the baroreceptors, if you all remember that from chemistry class, and how they are involved in controlling blood pressure and heart rate. 690.
690.
Yes, 690. So certainly with the neurogenic shock, you get the hypotension. These are the clinical manifestation. Bradycardia, certainly heat loss, dry skin, and of course this poikilothermia, which is taking on the temperature of the environment. So these patients, they can have cool or warm skin. You may have cool or warm skin. And just let me interject here by, I was sharing with Kim, when you think about what happens during shock, that you think about decreased tissue perfusion because you have decreased cardiac output, then when you think about the medications that are used, then obviously I'm not only treating the manifestation of the symptoms of what has happened, but doesn't it make sense that I also have to treat the cardiac system in order to generate increased cardiac output, right? So I'm either going to increase my preload or decrease my afterload medications, or I'm going to have to use a drug that is going to strengthen the contraction of the heart so that I can increase my cardiac output. And it is the same with hypertensive crisis. Not only will you treat the symptoms, but you also have to treat not only the underlying cause, but also you have to treat the blood pressure, right? And I'm sure those of you who have had the critical care rotation, what have you seen? What medicine drip did you see them use to treat high blood pressures? Anyone? Okay, labetalol, a drip. Levo for high blood pressure. For high blood pressure. Nipride, have you all seen? Okay, so Nipride is a medication that they use. And not only do the doxy IV, have you seen them, those of you who work as techs or during your critical care rotation, the medication that is wrapped in like the brown bag or something. You've seen that, right? Nipride. Nye and pride, N-I-P-R-I-I. Yes, because light decomposes it. So, and there's the antibiotic they use. So you might see that with your critical care rotation as well. So let's get back to stages of shock, of course. Initially, shock is not evident to any of the healthcare providers. And certainly because the body, again, has shifted and trying to compensate, you get a shifting metabolism change from aerobic, where we use oxygen, to anaerobic, because it's it's attempting to conserve energy. So you get that lactic acid accumulation, and of course, certainly that must be removed by the blood and is broken down by the liver. So you get, remember, aerobic uses oxygen and anaerobic doesn't use the oxygen, but because it's not using oxygen, you get that accumulation of lactic acid. So then what labs would you anticipate seeing? A lactic acid, right. So that was the initial stage of shock, of course, which is not always evident to us. We don't always know it. We don't always see it. That is the patient who may come back from surgery who initially may have a low blood pressure, but you may not think that the blood pressure, again, is dangerous. So certainly when the body tries to compensate, which is the second stage, you get this neural response that we talked, that I was mentioning with Melissa, in this hormonal response. And if you look at page 690, it'll talk about those chemo barrier receptors. So you do get this biochemical compensatory mechanism where your body is trying to maintain homeostasis. Again, just that outline that I've showed you before of the danger of shock, of course, is you get this systemic inflammatory response syndrome, and of course, which eventually, if not treated properly, will lead to multiple organ dysfunction syndrome, which certainly impacts all of our target organs. Okay, so again, if you all recall from your chemistry class, remember that with lined in those blood vessels, that we have those baroreceptors in our carotid and aortic bodies that activate. And remember, these not only these contribute to the blood vessel dilating and constricting. All right. So this, of course, so when our heart is not doing what it's supposed to do, remember, it will respond, then of course we have to get our, we get a, not only a neuro or a neurohormonal response. So these baroreceptors that line our vessel walls, of course, cause vasoconstriction, because what does vasoconstriction do? Increases blood pressure. So what the body is trying to do is increase venous return to the heart. Okay, and of course we talked about impaired GI motility, because certainly, unfortunately, because the blood flow, venous return is trying to shunt everything back to our core area, and of course because of vasodilation, that decreased blood flow in the capillaries, certainly the skin is cool and the skin is clammy, but you will not see this in aseptic patients, because they are trying to do what? Also fight an infection. So of course they typically are warm and flushed. And then of course shunting blood from our lungs to try to, you all remember during your respiratory lecture, how you have the ventilation and perfusion mismatch during your respiratory lecture. So of course One of the other compensatory mechanism, of course, is for our bodies to try to utilize all of the lung space that it can so that we can certainly bring back oxygen to our vital organs so that we can meet myocardial oxygen demands. Okay, if our deficit is corrected, then certainly our patient can recover. But certainly, if it's not corrected during this stage with our help, then the patient will progress to our progressive stage. And that is when our compensatory mechanisms fail. So of course, again, is when we're not able to meet the oxygen demand of our tissues and all of the compensatory mechanisms that our body is using fail, then we do, unfortunately, without aggressive interventions, it will lead to multiple organ dysfunction syndrome. And here is certainly just a map of that syndrome. Decreased stroke volume, which leads to decreased cardiac output, which leads to decreased cellular oxygen supply, which certainly will lead to decreased tissue perfusion. So certainly, if my cellular metabolism is impaired, then my organs will fail. And certainly, you all have observed with patients that are in shock, most of them third space. That's not only a compensatory mechanism, of course, but because of decreased cellular perfusion and altered capillary permeability, remember that I am now getting a shifting into that extravascular area. And then, of course, remember, if that shifting is occurred, what else is impaired is my sodium, my ion pump mechanism. So my sodium is accumulating, right, in the wrong place. I'm not getting good exchange for potassium. My magnesium levels are off. The calcium levels, remember calcium, when you get that influx of calcium, how it helps the muscles to contract. So of course, this alludes to the body at this stage. Typically, patients, unfortunately, have reached a point of no return. And of course, again, we get that diffuse profound edema, which you all, I'm sure, have seen anasarca in your rotations in the critical care unit. And then, of course, how does it impact, again, the pulmonary system? We get pulmonary edema, because where does pulmonary edema come from? Where is the fluid going? The lungs, and I'm not getting good return. Right? Because if my cardiac output is impaired, then my pulmonic circulation is impaired as well. Okay, and then the course here, what do I expect to see manifested in the alveoli? Certainly fluid in the lungs. What does it sound like? Fluid in the lungs sounds like crackles initially, and certainly most of these patients are ventilated. And they're not only ventilated because they need the ventilation, but they're also ventilated because it's therapeutic. Because what will a vent do to my body? Assist with what? Yes, not only assist with the work, but also it will bring oxygen to my vital organs. So therapeutically, these patients are often, certainly they decompensate and may often need ventilation assistance, but certainly therapeutically, it's going to bring oxygen back to my vital organs. And of course, if cardiac output falls, then again, as we have repeatedly said, decreased peripheral perfusion, hypotension. Certainly if blood is shunting to my core, then I'm going to get weak peripheral pulses. And certainly if blood and oxygen is lacking to my peripheral organs, then certainly my distal extremities certainly would become ischemic. And you've seen that. And of course, because my coronary arteries are also lacking perfusion, then of course, dysrhythmias can occur. The heart muscle will die. Some of these patients, because if we get that increased fibrinogen response, may have a myocardial infarction. And of course, eventually the heart will deteriorate and die. And then certainly, here's clinical manifestations of the mucosal barrier. The GI system without lack of oxygen becomes ischemic. Certainly, our normal flora just operating in our bowel tract because of increased permeability of the tissues and the cells. Certainly, this normal flora could potentially translocate or locate into another. So think about the implications of certainly being lined at a place that it's supposed to be. So of course, these patients may develop bleeding, they may develop ulcers, and a decreased ability to absorb necessary nutrients. And we again have talked about the impact of shock to our renal system. Hypoperfusion will often lead to renal tubular ischemia because though the kidneys will respond in a compensatory mechanism, certainly it is not without having the impact of having the lack of oxygen and nutrients. So certainly you will see patients in the progressive stage of shock, most of them are on dialysis because their kidneys are not working, and we have to have a mechanism to filtrate the toxins in their body. And of course, if their kidneys are working, then certainly you expect to see decreased renal urine output. And then the liver fails. Of course, the liver is responsible for metabolizing drugs and waste. So what will I see? Jaundice, elevated enzymes, loss of immune function, and certainly these patients are at, because the clotting mechanism certainly is impaired, they are at risk for bleeding. And of course, because we have transferred from an aerobic where I'm using oxygen to conserve, and where the cells are using oxygen to conserve energy, it transfers to an anaerobic metabolism. But because of that, I get this accumulation of lactic acid. And this is that irreversible stage. Pretty much when patients get to, in shock, get to that progressive level, we pretty much are at the irreversible stage, unless they are at unless they are at a facility where certainly aggressive treatment has taken place. And of course, again, the map, you see decreased circulating volume, all the same, follows the same route, decreased circulating volume, decreased venous return, decreased stroke volume, decreased cardiac output, of course, which eventually leads to impaired cellular metabolism. Okay, so of course, patients at this stage of irreversible stage, hypotension, hypoxemia, tachycardia may or may not worsen, only because depending on where the patient is, they could have tachycardia or they might have bradycardia, depending on the type of stroke. And of course, the organs start to shut down, recovery is unlikely. How do we manage these patients? Of course, we, in collaborating care for these patients, we have to first identify patients who are at risk for shock. In the hospital setting, what is the primary group or population of individual who is at risk for shock?
Elderly.
Okay, elderly. Before we get to the elderly, you're a nurse working on the floor. Who's at risk? Surgical patients, the patient who's come back from surgery, because they've just had, first they've had loss of blood volume loss, they've had fluid volume loss, or depending on the type of surgery, of course, they could have if it's a surgery where it involves us cutting or opening up or removing something that has to be cauterized and the potential for that to open up and that person bleed to death, then those are potentially our most vulnerable population for developing shock. Not only that, but patients in the hospital who arrive for infection, elderly patients who UTI, elderly patients with urinary tract infection that develop urinary sepsis, or any patients, pneumonia patients, believe it or not, that don't recover as well as we expect them to. So our successful management will involve intervening to control or eliminating the cause of why do they have decreased perfusion. Can we correct the cause? And certainly protecting target and distal organs from dysfunction. One of the medications that they use, dopamine, helps the renal arteries to perfuse, so you certainly will see that being used if patients have, when patients are in shock, and provision, of course, of multi-system supportive care. So what do we do? Again, what are our strategies? We always go back to our ABCs. If the airway is compromised, we want to ensure a patent airway, maximize oxygen delivery, of course, because our goal is to increase supply of oxygen to vital organs, which, of course, we want to optimize the cardiac output. We can do that with fluid replacement or with drugs that strengthen the cardiac muscle, drugs that decrease afterload so that the resistance to the ventricular resistance is decreased, or if my preload has been impacted, then of course a drug that has increased or decreased my preload, okay? And of course, mechanical ventilation. But what do we use? What is the cornerstone of therapy for any kind of shock when we know that the vasculature has been impacted because of low volume? Is, of course, using our crystalloids, our isotonic crystalloids such as normal saline or lactated ringers, because what we want to do certainly is to do volume expansion. Of course, it says here, if the patient does not respond to 2 to 3 liters of crystalloids, then we must look at some other means like blood administration, and certainly CVP monitoring may be instituted because we need to know what the heart is doing. And of course, complications, certainly, we might dilute them too much. So then we have to do corrective measures for that. And of course, the primary goal of drug therapy is correction of the decreased tissue perfusion. Of course, Laura talked about vasopressor drugs, which we have to use. Of course, you will see, of course, the sympathetic nervous system, if it speeds up the heart rate, then we have to use those type of drugs, norepinephrine and epi, to try to increase cardiac function. Certainly, to maintain a MAP, a mean arterial pressure, because that is the parameters that 60 to 61. And I think if you all look at your blood pressure, what is the formula for calculating the MAP? Okay, so if we don't see that on the monitor, is that the formula for the MAP? No, it's time 2 divided by something, right? You all remember that? That's the pulse pressure. But what is the what is the systolic times what divided by? You all remember that?
Systolic times 2 diastolic divided by 3.
Okay, thank you. I know something. So, or is it? Because I don't remember. Okay, so if you certainly, the optimum MAP is 60 to 65, and you will often see therapy gauge from the doctor when we are dealing with drips in the critical care unit for a patient who has shock. Typically, the intensivist may write the order that says keep the MAP at this level. And then when you titrate your drips, you're titrating your drips according to what the patient's MAP is. Certainly, these patients are on hemodynamic monitoring at this. And again, correction of decreased tissue perfusion, we may need nitro because it's a vasodilator. And of course, this is nipride, again, to maintain a map so that we can get good cardiac output. We often forget about it is the nurse at the bedside most often that is making the doctor aware of, okay, we have to, doctor, thank you for taking care of all the metabolic needs of the patient. But we still have to feed the patient, because if we want the patient to heal, we want the organs to heal if we're at a label, then the patient certainly needs nutrition, and nutrition has proven to decrease morbidity from shock, because certainly we need protein, right? They need, and by this time, unfortunately, the patient has declined, the skin system is probably declined because by virtue of them being in that position for that amount of time and maybe not turning them. So certainly they will need nutrition to help heal their skin. So nutrition is vital to decreasing morbidity from shock, and as the nurse at the bedside, we should be advocating for patients, because patients will go forever before someone says, well, we need to start a tube feed on the patient, or we need to implement, we need to talk about putting in a Dobhoff feeding tube, or let's, if we've gone far, let's think about a PEG tube so that we certainly can get proteins and necessary nutrients to the person. So for collaborative care for cardiogenic shock, obviously if cardiogenic shock involves impairment to the cardiac muscle, then I have to have a means to restore blood flow to the myocardium by restoring the balance between oxygen supply and demand, which certainly if there is as an impact of shock, if there's a narrowing or clot manifestation, which we've talked about, certainly you can do thrombolytic therapy, angioplasty with stenting, and certainly you can do revascularization. And remember, we talked about about patients who may even need ablations in the hospital because of conductivity impairment, of course, valve replacement. And certainly, you will see this not at that irreversible stage, but this will be at the stage where the doctor has decided, I know that if we, again, this is identifying what the underlying cause is, and if I correct the underlying cause and treat all the shock clinical manifestation, then the viability for that person increases. So, of course, hemodynamic monitoring, and again, we talked about, Mel brought up about the diuretics to reduce the preload, and certainly intra-aortic balloon pump and the ventricular assist device. I don't remember if that was in cardiac A or cardiac B, but if you, was that in the A? Balloon pumps, was that in B? So the balloon pump, of course, it looks like, when you go to the circus and they use those skinny balloons, you've seen those, a balloon pump. Sort of at the end of that, looks like that, goes into the aorta. And what it does, by inflating and deflating a balloon pump, it increases. No, yeah, we did talk about it, because I showed you the picture of the ventricular assist device, where the person was, it almost looks like a Holter monitor, where it helps to stimulate the ventricle, and that the ventricular assist device helps to assist the ventricle to contract. And most of those individuals are on a transplant list. So that's like an interim for a transplant. But that intra-aortic balloon pump certainly sits in the aorta. And of course, it helps to increase cardiac perfusion back to the heart, and it helps the heart to return more blood. And of course, for hypovolemic shock, certainly fluid replacement. And there's the 3-to-1 rule, 3. Isotonic crystalloid for everyone, of course, and certainly restoring the circulating volume, but trying to eliminate fluid loss. So obviously, if the fluid loss is a result of surgery, the patients usually go back to surgery to correct that. And then septic shock, of course, fluid replacement to restore perfusion. Always with a patient who's in shock, they're probably, more than likely, yes, definitely will have hemodynamic monitoring, vasopressor drug therapy, vasopressins. And of course, antipyretics, right? If it's a patient who is septic, and then of course corticosteroids, so you can get that response to help to main, not only maintain but to increase blood pressure. And certainly antibiotics after cultures are obtained, and certainly the broad spectrum antibiotics are given first. That makes sense because why? Because I have no idea. I have no idea what the source of infection is or what the etiology is. I don't know. So then of certainly broad spectrum until we have identified by virtue of, you know, doing the blood cultures or doing, if the person was had pneumonia and that was the primary reason that eventually they decompensated and ended up in shock, then certainly getting a sputum culture and any of those are given based on the organism that's identifying. And of course, certainly patients that are in shock, certainly patient, anybody, not person, but body that's under stress in the hospital, we expect to see glucose levels that are all over the place. Right? Glucose levels that are all over the place. So certainly we're going to, I'm sure those of you who are doing your ICU rotations, you are certainly not doing a rotation without checking what the glucose level is, because they may need insulin. And certainly not only shock patients, but almost every patient in the hospital gets some sort of prophylactics, right? Stress ulcer prophylactics we usually get, and what do they use at Shore Health? Protonix and DVT, prophylactis, and what do they use at Shore Health?
Lovenox.
Okay, and certainly for neurogenic shock, we want to certainly look at spinal stability, treating clinical manifestations. So not only do you have to find out what is the underlying cause, but I also have to treat the clinical manifestation. So for my neurogenic shock patient, that means I have to treat, even with the shock patient, hypotension. I have to address the low heart rates, which means they need vasopressors for their blood pressure and atropine for their heart rate, and certainly monitor for hypothermia. And then, of course, anaphylactic shock, hopefully, if we have gotten to them in time, if you are the nurse who's monitoring the patient during a cardiac cath and the doctor does his initial injection, if you've ever seen the cardiac cath done, the initial injection, of course, is going to be the hallmark that's going to tell you what's going to happen with the patient. That's usually when all hands are on deck and everyone is really watchful, because if you get through that 15 minutes, then you know you probably, that won't be a potential complication. Not to say the doctor won't perforate artery or perforate the myocardium, but at least if I've gotten through that first initial 15 minutes after they've done their initial injection test dose, then usually the nurse is there with epi, of course, because she may have to inject epi. And then, of course, what is diphenhydramine? Benadryl. And of course, again, maintaining a patent airway, bronchodilators, epinephrine, and ET tube is necessary. Yes, ma'am.
I saw a cath on Wednesday, and they have three nurses in there, and these are staff up.
Oh, because one is monitoring, right?
Monitoring, one is circulating.
One is circulating. Doing the sedation, right? Okay, yeah. So, of course, again, fluid replacement, and then, of course, hopefully steroids because of stress response, and then we'll increase, if hypotension persists, it may or may not. And then the potential complications, of course, is the SIRS, and some of the patients in the critical care unit have already progressed to this state where we get the systemic inflammatory response, because your body is under, remember, the cardiac muscle, if it's cardiogenic, has been insulted. If it's a neurogenic, it's because the spinal cord has been injured, and of course anaphylactic, because you've gotten this inflammatory cascade that has started. And then, of course, you get this generalized, remember, it's almost like a lupus response, where your body, your immune factors start your immune factors certainly start to, again, it's a compensatory mechanism that has gone haywire. So instead of stopping the cascades continue. Remember, too much of something is never good for you, right? You can take too much of iron, which is good for you, too much of oxygen. Remember, because we don't do 100% oxygen. Too much of oxygen, anything too much is bad. So one of the potential complications of a patient being in an irreversible stroke or stroke is SIRS. The other complication is MODS, which is the multiple organ dysfunction syndrome. It is the failure of two or more organ systems. We cannot maintain homeostasis in spite of any interventions. So the kidneys fail, the livers fail, something cardiogenic shock, the cardiac muscles fail. And this again is the point of no return. So patients at this stage unfortunately end up your organs fail and you die. And then again, the relationship, you've seen this before of the different types of shock and what happens. Eventually you get multiple organ dysfunction, which leads to these targeted organs in your body, unfortunately, and that's the end. Okay, any questions? And certainly you can email me, and if you do, I will shoot it back to the entire class. And I may, yeah. If you, it doesn't matter. I'll just be looking everything, okay?